Good morning, everyone. I'm Carla Koppell. It's a great pleasure to be here with all of you this morning and to be here with this marvelous group of people to talk about how we better reflect diversity, equity, and inclusion issues in education. And I can't think of a better group of folks to have this conversation with because they really come at it from a whole range of different perspectives. So the whole ecosystem. You have their bios in your materials for the conference, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time introducing them. For the session this morning, we'll talk as a group for about half an hour, and then we'll open up for questions and comments, both from those of you here in the audience with us this morning and those of you who are attending virtually. I know there are many virtual attendees as well. We will not forget you. And this is an issue that is close to my heart. I came to Georgetown University several years ago specifically to work on how we bring issues of equity and inclusion into international affairs education. And I've been excited to see how much the attention has increasingly been focused on this critical need. And hopefully we can talk more about why that is and how we're approaching it in our conversation. But suffice it to say, I'm thrilled to be here with all of you today. I'm gonna start with a couple of rounds of questions and then some discussion. And I am honored to have next to me, and I'm gonna start with her, the inaugural ambassador for diversity, equity, and inclusion issues at the State Department. Madam Ambassador, congratulations on creating such an important role.
Thank you.
And maybe we could start, because obviously we're educating the experts of the next generation, the leaders of the next generation, but they also need jobs and roles in society. And so I would love if you could share with us a little bit the amazing innovations that you're bringing to the State Department that are really creating a demand signal and at the same time really transforming the way we think about these issues in the international affairs space.
I love that framing. Thank you.
Good.
good morning, everyone. I've been at this for 1 year and, 14 days, so it has been a whirlwind. I think all of you know when you're a startup, it is a crazy, so we're building as we fly in the department. We've had a discussion about the importance of diversity and inclusion for a very long while, and this administration, this secretary, decided he was putting his money where our money where his mouth was, as it were. So, taxpayers and all of that.
Our collective money.
Yes, indeed. Collective money. So setting up the office, sending a very clear signal to the workforce and beyond by having me report directly to him, by having a regularly scheduled set of meetings to talk about what I'm doing, what I need from him to help move it forward. I will tell you, he hasn't missed a meeting since we began. In fact, he calls them a little sooner sometimes than I want. But anyway, he's committed. A crackerjack staff, a budget. An office, if any of you know the Department of State, it's on the 7th floor, so that's where all the people who are leaders in the building sit. So he was sending the signal to the workforce immediately. Immediately by putting me on the committees that select Chief of Missions, Deputy Chief of Mission, Deputy Assistant Secretaries, Principal Officers. So that got the attention of leadership in the building, because if you want to be selected for leadership, if you want to continue to have positions of leadership, then you are going to show that commitment to diversity and inclusion. We changed the way we look at leaders, our vetting process, communicating that we want to make sure that people are setting up work atmospheres that don't allow or contribute toxicity. We set up a data working group, one of the first things I did, because nobody believes anything unless they can see the numbers. So trying to find data scientists and getting the numbers. And I thought my challenge would happen when I got into the department and got all the numbers and scrubbed them and looked at where, you know, women were being stopped or African Americans or Hispanics, et cetera. Made my recommendations and started telling people things we needed to change, and I thought I'd get big resistance then. I got resistance asking for the numbers. That can be a challenge in many organizations, and I will tell you, not only did we get the numbers, but we have put them on our website so that the entire workforce can see who we are and where we are and hold us accountable. Accountability, transparency, intentionality. We're not playing. And we are communicating, you know, join us if you want to remain successful in this organization. We have put in our precepts for the Foreign Service, starting in the 22-23 cycle for promotion, that if you want to get promoted, if you want to seriously be considered for a position higher than the one that you are in right now, you need to be able to put down in black and white not only how you are supporting diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility, but what is the impact of what you say that you are doing. And it's got to be in black and white. And just as we hold people accountable for leadership and management and judgment and substantive knowledge, et cetera, DEI is on there too. We negotiated it with our union. So this is something, it's not going away regardless of what happens in 2022. It's in black and white. We've added it to the civil service. We are working now to add it to the work requirements for our locally engaged staff. And so again, this is where the rubber hits the road if you want to be promoted. So we're trying to reward you for that good behavior and hold folks accountable as well. And in these ways and many others that I've got ahead of me, we are making sure that the playing field is indeed level, that transparency helps everyone, everyone. And I'll stop there.
That's wonderful. And I really appreciate the emphasis you're placing both on the composition of the workforce and who's there and the climate for that workforce to thrive. Because I will admit, when I first started working on this, these issues, I thought, oh, we just go into universities and we change what's taught. And it'll all work itself out. And what you realize is that the ecosystem involves who's there and what it is they're saying and the atmosphere they're creating, what that atmosphere is like, whether it creates space for the kinds of discussions about equity and inclusion that we need to have and whether it creates an atmosphere where everybody can thrive, and also the content and the nature of the discussions. And so, Dawn, I would love for you, I know you've been an incredible innovator around how we imbue our educational system, higher education, with global awareness, with a focus on international affairs. Talk a little bit about what the strategies are for doing that and for advancing that sort of across the educational ecosystem.
Thank you for that question. And I think the big thing is thinking about how do we provide opportunities for all students to even be touched by global perspectives, global initiatives, because we won't have that pathway into international affairs if we have a large number of students that don't even know about the concept. Some of us come from institutions that have Title VI funding. So you've got area studies programs. I'm a beneficiary. I went through African studies. But even at those institutions, there's a percentage of students who aren't involved. Then you think about the institutions that don't have that kind of support for area studies, language study, global and international studies, and how do you get those institutions and students from those institutions involved in this kind of work? And it comes from curricular change. And what we have been doing is working with institutions across the country, including some that are represented here, to look at how do we integrate international perspectives, global perspectives, into the curriculum for all students. As institutions are developing institutional learning outcomes, is global learning a part of those outcomes? Beyond your mission statement saying we're an institution for the world, but what what are the actual outcomes? Do you have something about global perspectives? Do you have something about learning across differences and acting and working across differences? And until we can embed that in the curriculum so that all students have access, those pathways won't be clear for all students to participate. And so that's been our main function, is looking at how can we impact all students. And I was so happy to hear you mention the data. And that's one thing that we encourage institutions to do. When they're taking this sort of perspective, when you look at what you have currently, and you can say, okay, who is participating in our global studies programs? Who's participating in international relations? Who's participating in study abroad? And then you see those gaps. It reminds you, okay, what can we do to make sure that all of the students can be touched by it, and then they can learn and be exposed to another pathway to go a bit further. So that's our strategy. And as I said, we've been working with a lot of institutions who have embedded this into their framing.
That's really helpful. And I want to just draw you out for a second, because I appreciated when we talked beforehand, you were talking about sort of the roles of study abroad, the roles of both the integration of these issues into core curricula as well as dedicated classes. Could you talk just a little bit about that? Because I think it's important. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. And I think one of the challenges that we have had in some spaces is, of course, study abroad, when you look at who participates, there are a large number of students who are underrepresented. And so what has happened over the years is we have been looking at how can we make sure that study abroad is embedded in the curriculum? How can we make sure that there are global learning outcomes that are part of education abroad? How can we look at themes that are relevant globally with education abroad? So, for example, and I'll use a personal anecdote. For me, I used to take students to Ghana. My background is in African studies. And one of the things the students, one time I thought I had really failed. We were traveling to the north after being in Accra for a while. And one of the students said, oh, we're finally going to see the real Ghana. And before I could, correct her, the other student said, what do you mean the real Ghana? There are urban and rural issues all around the world. There are, we can look at these issues at home, and so it just opened up a broader conversation. And that's what we're thinking about when we talk about having these types of experience abroad, where students are thinking about poverty in different spaces, and they're able to understand when they're thinking about racism in global contexts and how that's very different. What you may experience at home is very different than what you may be experiencing abroad. So it's helping students connect not just the topic that they're working at in the country where they're studying, but to these broader global themes that will continue to be with them as they go into their professional careers and continue to be lifelong learners.
That's great. And I love that idea of how you tie global themes to whatever it is you're talking about. Miguel, you and I have been working together for several years. Miguel is part of a group of deans that I've been convening for about 4 years now to talk about how to bring diversity, equity, and inclusion issues into international affairs and public policy education. And I know we spend a lot of time talking about what needs to happen, where the gaps are, and what will make change. Tell the group a little bit about that.
You have a couple hours. good morning, everybody. Thanks for the invite. Let's see, what needs to change? The first, the one thing that we've had some success in is representation in the student body. You now have, for example, at elite universities, is usually 9% African American, 9 to 10% Latino. It's higher Latino, obviously, in Texas, in California, and Florida. So now that's not parity by any stretch of the imagination, but it's a lot better than certainly when I was in school. That's one area of progress. We've done a much better with the curriculum. There is much more awareness of difference, of diversity, of attitudes, of histories, of cultures. I think that has also changed in the last 30 or 40 years. We still have, and I think this is true in most of the social science disciplines, there is still the universality of the United States is assumed. If you find, the standard joke is if you write about gender in Iowa, you're writing about gender. If you write about gender in Ghana, you're writing about Ghana. And that continues to be a problem. And we get a lot of students who say, look, I didn't come here to learn the OECD catechism. I came to explore other things. So that's a problem. The biggest one, the one that concerns me the most, is the almost total lack of progress on diversity of the faculty. When I got to Princeton, me and the Stagosauruses, there was maybe 3.5% Latino. maybe 3 to 4% African American. The numbers today are 3.5% Latino, 3-4% African American. And if you take out African American studies, and if you take out the Spanish and Portuguese departments, those go down to about 2%. And this is, everybody talks about the pipeline, but it's really significant that nobody takes responsibility for the pipeline. They go, well, we just don't have any. And I go, well, make some. we have the funding, we have the will. I think that remains a big problem, not just because of the difference in appearance, let's say. It's important to have a black woman, for example, with a blackboard of calculus behind her. I think those kinds of symbols are really important. It's also perspectives. It's just awareness that there is a different way of doing things, that there are different assumptions being made, particularly when it comes to, and you can't perfectly correlate class with ethnic identity, but pretty close in this country. One of the other things is the absence of working class faculty in elite institutions, which also creates a problem because they don't understand the problems that students have. They've come from very privileged, and all of a sudden a student says, I can't afford to buy a book. And they don't quite get it. So I think the biggest frontier is that diversity in the faculty, that diversity in the administration. Actually, in the administration, we've done pretty well. It's in the faculty, just the core faculty that the students are going to see every day. You don't see that many people who don't look like a particular type.
Thanks so much. So really, I think you've done collectively a terrific job of laying out these issues that relate to the sort of the content and approach and pedagogy of learning, the climate within institutions, whether those are professional institutions or educational institutions, and the composition of the folks who are in those institutions and whether they bring their perspectives and their expertise in to create a fulsome ecosystem. I want to pivot us now to talk a little bit about the tools that are becoming available and strategies that are becoming available that we know begin to advance the conversation and make it easier for us to move this agenda forward. Madam Ambassador, I mean, maybe you could, I know there was a great new announcement on the changes in the Foreign Service exam, for example. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. As our union pointed out, we've had a written exam as the gateway for people joining the Foreign Service. And then it's been tinkered with essays in between or just going straight to an oral examination. I, in fact, was on the board of examiners, so I administered the oral examination for a year. So I'm very familiar with it and stand by the fact that it does a very good job of asking questions about the sort of issues you are going to come up against as a diplomat. It's a good exam. The written exam, like so many, is a way of winnowing the number of people that you actually have to interview in person. But it also was highly effective at keeping out women and minorities. That is the reality. And so we have announced a change in the last couple of days of no longer using the written exam as that gateway so that we are able to look at the whole person. So people will get a score on the exam, but also will continue with the essays. And that way we believe that we are going to have a more meritorious entry way as well, because more men pass the written exam, but the reality is more women pass the oral exam. So they're being block people who, in fact, are able to do extremely well in what we need from diplomats or being blocked by that standard test. So we are making that change, and we're making others that will be announced in the coming days. The issue on the pipeline is one that we, too, have struggled with and recognize that those numbers that we have at the bottom hadn't changed, and I think ours was from 2008 and 2020, that the percentage of women competing for promotion is exactly the same. or that, in fact, numbers of African Americans have, in fact, gone down since the year that I came into the Foreign Service. So it's also retention in our business, not just getting people in, but keeping them in. And so we have to do a lot of barrier analyses. And then with the results of that analysis, say to people, we've got to do things a different way. Do not say to me, but we have always done it this way. That will make me smack you or put you out of the room, one or the other. That, you know, what is it, the insanity?
It's a little undiplomatic.
Well, yes, yeah. But we're in a hurry, we're in a hurry. But, you know, we keep saying we're the best, we're the brightest, we're brilliant. We are, we can solve this. If we're serious about it, we can solve this. So, okay.
That's great. No, and I was thrilled to see you all announce paid internships as well.
Yes.
It was a great development.
Yes, yes, that is a great beginning. We have more to do, write your Congress people, because we have to keep it going.
Yeah. No, seriously, write your Congress. Yeah. You've been an incredible innovator in developing materials for teaching and learning and enabling faculty and instructors to move this agenda forward. Talk a little bit about the things you've developed and the other things you like that you see out there that you would recommend to people who are with us today.
Yeah. I think one thing I would start with, there's a tool that we use, and there are colleagues here from Stockton University who can speak to this, is our Global Learning Value Rubric. Our value rubrics are rubrics to assess student learning, and the one about global learning integrates diversity, equity, and inclusion and global learning because it forces you to look at power and privilege. It forces you to look at hierarchies, both at home and in the community in which you're working. And I think that's one of the most powerful tools that we've developed, and institutions have used it in many, many different ways. With the similar framing, I know there are also some folks here from Florida International University. The way that global learning has been defined at Florida International University is related to diverse people collaborating and analyzing problems that transcend boundaries. That, for some, you may say, oh yeah, that's it. That was not the norm 5 to 10 years ago in the ways that people thought about global learning for all students. And so I think that type of framing, coupled with the value rubrics and the work that JY and others have done at Stockton, that has helped move this conversation forward and beyond those that are just in area studies or those, as I said before, that are in the specialized programs to something that all students can see. And I think the other thing for us is going back to this pathway or pipeline, however you want to describe it. Again, if we don't have more students who are participating in these activities and get these perspectives, we're not going to get more students involved. I believe it was in early 2021, a few colleagues and I, the president of Benedict College, the president of Elon, and a few others, wrote a white paper looking at the importance of engaging students in this work, and diverse students. And two of the things we said, one you've talked about, are the gaps. Who is participating and why aren't we seeing more students? But we also talked about the harm that it can do in terms of other countries understanding the U.S. And when we're not sending a reflection of who we are in the United States, it plays into harmful stereotypes and other factors that can be damaging. And yes, people say, oh, well, we have people of color in the media. I remember that because I'm from Indiana, and when I was in China many years ago, people said, oh, you know Reggie Miller. That was the person of color that they knew because of the NBA. But when they're seeing students engaged in these study abroad programs in other places, that makes a huge difference. But I think the key is the framing and how we are broadening it and those resources that you can apply to any discipline or any setting. The last thing I would say is the work that we've done partnering with professional schools and looking at how you can, again, integrate these perspectives into professional programs. So you are studying nursing. You look at the accreditation standards, and there are standards that are related to cultural competency, cultural humility, but how do you build in these global perspectives so that whether you're going to practice in Accra, as we said, or I guess I could say Lagos, or in Indianapolis, you need to have those skills.
That's great. I think when I first came, as I said, I was really focused on sort of what is being taught and learned by students. And what I realized was that while there was a lot of material out there related to this, it wasn't necessarily so easy to find. And so I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that we launched this year from Georgetown a database of material on international affairs that is all either by diverse authors, or so authors of a wide range of backgrounds, or material that is relating diversity, equity, and inclusion issues to the range of subfields in international affairs. And there's some flyers and you can get information about it outside, but it really was an attempt to say, it's not so hard. We can consolidate this information. You as instructors can make a choice as to what makes sense within a syllabus or a curriculum that you're putting together, but the material is out there and we're able to move this forward. I also just worked on this edited volume that came out from Oxford University Press this year that was an attempt to provide something that can create a foundation for teaching and learning simply because there was nothing out there. And really, we need to make it easier for folks to embrace this agenda and to move teaching and learning forward. And so I really appreciate the excellent work that you all have been doing. So Miguel, from your perspective, either as faculty or as dean, what do you think are the most useful tools that exist and strategies for either addressing issues of composition or issues related to the curriculum, or I guess also culture?
So the curriculum, I think the most important is, it's hard. It's not just about making a curriculum available. It's getting the curriculum, it's getting the horse to drink the water. And that has been a real problem. If you look at many international courses, if you look at anything remotely dealing with DEI, if you look at anything dealing with gender, what do you find? Classrooms mostly of women, and the DEI people of color. And that has been the biggest challenge at SPIA, at Princeton, is how do we get the folks who are not already converted into thinking about this? And we have run into quite a bit of opposition the last couple of years, because the minute you start using, you talk about power and identity, then a part of the student body, and yes, a part of the faculty starts saying, you know, you're preaching, now you're doing an ideology, you're not really sticking to the facts. I say, okay, we're a public policy school, we're not allowed to talk about power? is this the one P word that we're not allowed to use? Like the economists who don't recognize power? I always have to have the dig at economists. They make too much money. So the biggest problem, I think, is just getting the word out and getting people to take courses that they wouldn't take, getting people to take courses that might push them from their comfort zone. That's the next frontier. We've got all the courses, we've got the departments, we've got the representation, but we have to move out of those walls. One of the courses that I teach is a big lecture course on war. And what really strikes me is the amount of ignorance on the part of the students about what the world looks like. Mm-hmm. During the last couple of months, obviously, everybody's attention has been on Ukraine. And students say to me, wow, I didn't know war was going around. I said, no. What's new in Ukraine is that white Europeans are killing white Europeans. There's lots of wars going on throughout the world. I mean, have you ever heard of Yemen? Have you heard of Ethiopia? Have you heard of the Great Lakes? Have you heard? And yet they see this, they see the world through a very globally upper class lens. There is no conflict, there is no problem. And if you try to, how do you push that on them without them getting so resistant to it that you actually lost the battle?
Yeah, and I think it's a really important point. Both from the substance, there's too much ignorance of the research that you add value to your organization or to your policymaking when you have diverse perspectives that are brought in. So you see that conflict is resolved more durably, more quickly, and more successfully when you have diverse voices at a negotiating table, that your organization functions better when you have diverse voices involved. And people just don't know this research is out there, which is incredibly frustrating.
But it just this becomes really a problem when you've got representatives of the United States saying things. I remember when I did my dissertation on Mexico, and I remember going to an event, and the American ambassador to Mexico said, one of the reasons we have this great relationship is we've never been at war with each other.
Wow. Oh.
And, you know, and it would have been great if he was from Arizona or Texas or something like that, but he wasn't. And you see that the last 20 years, certainly some of the foreign policy choices that have been made people who didn't understand. Mm-hmm. There were people, I've been read too many accounts of the Iraq War and the going into the Iraq War. There were people making decisions about Iraq that did not know there's a difference between Shia and Sunni. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That is not just a question of representation, that's a question of stupidity. And we have to fight against that.
So how are you selling this?
I was hoping you were coming directly to me. First of all, I would like to ask, was that a political appointee, not a career person for the ambassador in Mexico?
just to clarify.
Yeah.
At that time, yeah.
No, I mean, part of it is right getting this message across. So how are you?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm nodding. You know, that description of what rooms look like when these issues come up. You know, we are all glad to be here, but I certainly have been at council events that don't look like this room. So hello, everyone. We certainly are addressing it, and indeed for every young person in here, we want you to join the Foreign Service. Let me be clear about that. And we're working hard so when you get to our organization, it is going to be an organization that you know from day one values you and your opinion and the knowledge you bring and the experiences that you bring, because we recognize we need you around the table. So that is why this work is being done now. But indeed, before I came back to the Department of State, I began to resist joining panels on diversity and inclusion because it looked like panels of brown people. And I have said, while it may be our burden as women and people with disabilities and brown people, it is European Americans' problem. And therefore, we need you on these panels as well. We are getting after it by putting it in our precepts. You don't get promoted unless you take the class. Meaningful initiation. When I was a student, we had to take certain courses to make sure that we were well aware of the world. And I don't know why a course on history and making sure it's a full course on history is not required for every student. I mean, so that's how we're getting after it. I think other agencies are looking at what we're doing at state. I must admit some envy among my colleagues when I tell them that we put it in the precepts for promotion, because it does concentrate the mind very quickly, I assure you. We do have our resistance at the mid-level, and I say they came by it honestly. We've been talking about this for a long time, so to be skeptical about our commitment is to be reasonable, quite frankly. But I wouldn't have taken this job if I did not feel this was the time to make and sustained change and commitment. And a lot of people are depending on us to get this right now. So all the students that you all are educating, we want them. Yeah.
Do you have any advice for Miguel about how you integrate this and bring along the sort of majority population and get everybody convinced and
Let me take this down.
I'm ready.
I think you touched on it, because I think one thing is the perception versus the reality, and looking at the history. And so I know some institutions I've been working with, in particular, looking at the inclusion of Black students in this type of work, and some students don't have any knowledge that Black folks, American Black folks, have been working around the world in many different contexts, as far back as Frederick Douglass when he was in the UK, you know, for the anti-slavery movement. Ida B. Wells collecting funds, you know, for anti-lynchings. John Lewis, Stokely Carmichael, you know, or Kwame Ture in the 1950s when Ghana was gaining its independence in other countries. Marion Wright Edelman, in her memoir, talks about how significant it was when she spent time in Russia. And so some institutions have focused on, okay, if we just tell the Black students about that legacy, or the book African American Foreign Correspondence, then they'll see that they're a part of it. But I argue all the students need to see that, so they realize that it's not just a certain type that you see going, but we all need to be a part of it. The other piece, and I think you hit on it, is it comes from faculty development and how it connects to your discipline and helping people see that it actually is meaningful and means something in your field. We've made the most progress, I think, working with some colleagues in engineering where they used to have a requirement from ABET that said you had to think about international engagement, you had to think about how culture impacted what you were building and creating, social work, another discipline, where you could say looking at the accreditors, and that has helped. But the key has to be when it comes from the faculty who are saying, we want to prepare students for life, work, and citizenship. And these are skills that they need for all three areas. And I think that has helped in some cases.
One thing that's been interesting and effective I've seen at schools is also when you create these courses on equity and inclusion issues, diversity issues, as electives, you only get the converted. Mm-hmm. But if you have them qualify either as part of the core for a given concentration or major, or as something that counts towards a distribution requirement, mm-hmm. then you begin to bring in a wider swath of the student body and can be really helpful in bringing in folks who may not want to grow up to be a gender advisor or a social inclusion advisor, but are interested in this material and willing to engage.
And can I add one thing, too? Yeah. And I think you touched on this. And if you don't only have the faculty of color teaching it, yeah. So they're hearing it and seeing it from a wide range of folks, not just those who say, well, you have a vested interest in pushing this. You know, right. No, we all do, because it's something that we all need for society.
Absolutely. I'm going to open up the floor to questions, and we'll start maybe in the room. I could keep asking. Ah, good. A gentleman with his hand up. Several. I'll start here, and then we'll turn to folks who are online so we make sure that they're included as well. There are two people towards the back of the room, and if you could maybe stand and say who you are and your affiliation, that would be great.
Thank you. I'm Dan Whitman at George Washington University, which is across the street from what was the name of the place? And I, Ambassador, I also worked at the Board of Examiners. Your announcement, I think it was earlier this week. No, it was HR, right? About changes in the exam.
As you know, this is a critical question. Yes, HR.
Don't you?
Possibly.
AFSA went ballistic, and Eric Rubin, who's on the record many times for being fully in favor of diversity and inclusion, was furious. What's going on? Is it that they simply that they were not involved in the discussion? Because I can't imagine they would oppose what you've actually done.
Yes. All right. Well, I won't tell you about my private conversations with the head of APSA. However, their objections, I believe, are largely centered on the fact that they were not consulted. And he made clear in the statement, I think two statements, said that was the lead concern. And I think the second statement they released did, say that they didn't object necessarily to the changes being made. In all private honesty, it was a button, it was released before it should have been released, because we do, of course, consult with AFSA, and they have been briefed in the meanwhile. So you should see more positive statements coming out on the content on it. They're still mad about not being consulted before it was done. So I would say.
Great. Second question here, and then we'll go online. Maybe, oh, or the two, and then we'll go online.
Thank you. My name is Mark Mooney. I'm with the Florida International University. I teach foreign policy and national security, and a lot of students apply for the Pickering and Rangel internships. And so I think this might apply to everyone, if you could tell us where it stands, because I know from the students I've seen, there's been a good mix of diversity and inclusion, but I don't know if that's more of a national situation, and will it change, and how will it change, so that I can advise these great students. Thank you.
Yeah, keep them coming. It is an extraordinary program. We are bringing in brilliant people with degrees, although I remind everyone, you do not need a bachelor's degree to come into the Foreign Service. You need to only pass the test. So there's no college requirement. But they're great, and they are very successful. I will say that the department has had a spotty record on providing them the support and recognition that they deserve, and we are changing that. So it's a great program. Both of them are great programs, and I think we're expanding them. They're good.
That's great. We'll take one question online.
We will take a virtual question from Mojubalu Olofunke Okome.
Good morning. I'm a professor of political science at Brooklyn College. And my college actually has similar problems with the elite institutions or the private institutions that have money. In terms of the composition of the faculty body, and also the people teaching in international affairs sort of courses. The whole discipline of political science has a problem with diversity. And in my graduate student years at Columbia University, it was really, it was traumatic, the absence. And then the assumption that it's because of some sort of meritocracy. I wasn't born in the US, I was born in Nigeria. So it was really very strange to me. And it remains strange because we're living in a concocted sort of reality where, you know, structurally some things are made impossible. And then, you know, we kind of reify the categories that we have created. But that being said, you know, I love all the good intentions and the aspirations, but I'm very frustrated because I've lived here for 41 years. And diversity remains a huge challenge. And then pipelines seem to, like I said, reify the differences that we love to say are relevant because it's merit-based. So many of my students are first generation to go to college. They are working while going to school. They have sometimes families and a lot of challenges. And I dare say there doesn't seem to be room for many of such students around, you know, the places that are doing these things. They can't even afford to do study abroad because it's expensive and we don't have scholarships for them. So what really concretely is going to be done to include such populations? And then also to make people, skeptical people, believe that we're committed to change. Because for me, you know, I have become very cynical. And it's not because I am not, I left the APSA, you know, because it's hostile space for, you know, they're not interested in anything other than, you know, looking at America's role in the world. So is that what our interest in international studies should be? Even when we hire, people always want to hire people who focus on the US, you know. So it's a really, it's a conundrum as far as I'm concerned, and I'd like to be enlightened to see if I'm wrong.
Yeah. All right, wow.
Thank you so much. Dawn, do you want to comment a little bit on the tactics and strategies that can work in such an institution?
Yeah, I think I would like to. I think one thing in particular that stands out immediately is that although at some institutions, study abroad is seen as the best practice for global learning, there are many other ways for students to have global experiences that don't involve leaving the country and don't involve mobility. We've seen them, especially over the last 2 years, but many of them were already being developed in the process. So when the key is developing quality experiences for students. This could be community-engaged ethical learning. So you're working with a community that's culturally different or could be from your own community group. And students are learning in their demonstrating those skills about what it's like to work with people who are different from you, solve problems with people who are different from you. This could be working with a nonprofit, could be working in a corporation, but that's one strategy that a number of institutions have done. And I'm not here to defend APSA, I'm not a political scientist, but I was a co-editor of an APSA publication called Teaching Civic Engagement Globally. In that publication, you will see some examples of ways that you can work ethically in your communities that are more diverse, perhaps, than your own institution. Some people say, oh, my institution's not diverse. The other thing is, what types of experiences and what are you having students do on campus? Are you really having students engage with other students in significant ways? You know, a lot of institutions like to say, oh, we have, you know, students from over 50 different countries. Well, how are they engaging? Is it beyond sort of the tokenization where you say, oh, you know, today we're going to have you talk about what it's like being in Nigeria, speak for everyone? No. Are we going to have the nuanced conversations and understandings of what it may be? So I think that's another strategy. You mentioned, and I was so happy you mentioned this earlier, the paid internships. What types of paid internship opportunities are there for students? We've seen a number of institutions, from SUNY to University of Wisconsin to many others, that during the pandemic, they have set up virtual paid internships with institutions and colleagues around the world. So students were working on web design for nonprofits in East Asia or other parts of the world. So that's another way that you can have students have these meaningful global experiences if they cannot study abroad. And yes, it takes funding from the university to offer professional development for faculty if you want them to do this work. And that, I think, is the biggest key. So I think I will stop with those examples.
Sure. I have this speech that I'd like to give to the students and to the faculty. You know, you may all be worthy, but you're very lucky. And the recognition to ask a person whose entire personality, professional ideal is based on their own merit to start questioning it is very, very hard. The things I have seen in faculty hiring meetings, things I have heard, it would blow your mind, or maybe not. Maybe you've heard them before. Especially in the academy, the ladder begins so early. If you don't get into the right college at 18, you're not going to get into the right graduate program at 25, and you're not going to get an assistant professorship at 30 or whatever it is, and you're probably not going to get tenure. So we've created this system where only... We believe that decisions that are being made by admissions officers about 17-year-olds are absolute meritocratic and absolute versions of the truth, as opposed to recognizing, well, you know, luck is one thing, but if you start seeing an overrepresentation of one group among the lucky, you should start wondering if it's really luck or something else. Now, this is not attacking somebody's right to be in a position. This is not attacking. This is what we have to be very careful with, that we approach it in a way that people do not feel threatened. But unfortunately, many of my colleagues still feel very threatened the minute you mention diversity, the minute you start mentioning, you start saying, well, why don't we look at this candidate? And not even that, even if you take the meritocracy seriously, the meritocracy is built in such a way that it tends to pick only a few lucky. I'm always picking on economists, but the entire culture of academic economics is not exactly gender neutral. It's a very male, if you will, or masculine, or alpha, whatever you want to call it. The same thing in political science. We have to start changing the culture. Not just in terms of different viewpoints, et cetera, but just so it doesn't reflect one single cultural set of standards, and that is what is acceptable and that is what is appropriate.
I really appreciate those perspectives. I would also add, I think that in a world that is increasingly diverse, where the range of identities in the workforce, in every area of the workforce, is increasing, the need for that cultural competency, the need to be able to navigate whether or not you're working permanently in one location or another, or traveling the world in an international capacity, is growing. And that diversity becomes part, navigating that successfully becomes part of professional success writ large. We could take another one online.
We will take our next virtual question from Jin In.
Good morning. My name is Jin In. I'm the Assistant Vice President at of Diversity and Inclusion at Boston University. I tell people in my school and my university that diversity and inclusion is the remarketed, repackaged version of something we did not do well nearly 400 years ago, and that's the United States Constitution motto, E pluribus unum. We were not able to make many of one, and so now this is the repackaged version. And I know that in this field, they've also added the J and the B, which is justice and belonging, to the DEI. I'm wondering if you have some examples from the panelists, how we've done well in the justice and belonging.
Well, one thing, there is, I am a product of financial aid. I think the financial aid, the scholarships and the financial aid assumptions of higher education is the best thing we do. The American dream is alive and well in universities. There is social mobility through universities. And I think we have to recognize, 65% of our students are pretty much on full financial aid. Now, that also means you've got 35% whose parents can afford $70,000 a year. So that gives you some idea. But I think we American universities should be very proud. I don't know of any other country where their universities serve as a social mobility device as they serve in the United States. And that's something to be proud of.
A great example. Other thoughts? Things that folks want to add?
One thing I would say, and I think this has come out of the global racial reckoning over the past 2 years, is we're seeing institutions, you know, similarly to what you described about changing criteria, we're seeing a change, whereas at some institutions, the criteria for studying abroad sometimes didn't really align with what was really required for studying abroad. So to participate in a study abroad program, you had to have a 3.5 GPA. And some said, was that really necessary? And were you blocking certain students from participating? So we're seeing some institutions that are loosening that. Again, they're saying, we're going to look at the letters of reference more. We're going to do a more holistic approach. Also, not being so rigid in terms of if a student has a history of being on academic probation, saying you automatically can't participate, to go back and say, okay, why was that? Oh, this student was a STEM major, and they took 3 STEM classes in the semester. They should have taken 2. They didn't have proper advising. We don't have enough advisors to advise the students. So I'm seeing that's a little of the J coming around as we're trying to be more expansive. So that's just one example that I've seen at more institutions over the past year.
You want to add something?
I don't know that I do.
Okay. Well, I have one, and it gives you credit.
There you go.
So there.
You go.
I think we're paying a lot of catch-up, but I think the fact that this administration has at least 50% female political appointees in the international affairs space is important progress. I don't know. You'll have better handle on the data overall, but it's the first time. And it's a little bit more broad-based than just saying, oh, we have the first female Secretary of State in Madeleine Albright, who just passed away. But that kind of progress is important, and there are more people of color as well being appointed.
Yes. Yeah, it is important, an important first step, and then the equity part of making sure that the voices and views are valued and welcomed, and anyone who is a minority or underrepresented or female in the national security sphere certainly knows the feeling of walking into the room and feeling like, wow, because I'm the only one here. I tell people, travel with a posse if you can, because it's lonely out there. I have had parents in my neighborhood, as we grapple with using the local school, and having parents, European American, tell me they don't want to send their children to the local school because they don't want their children to be a minority, or they don't want their children to be the only one. And this is an experience that Hispanics, African Americans, women in the national security field, and too many others grapple with on a daily basis. It's lonely when you're walking in the room and the expectation is not for your success. You know, I have to walk in recognizing that people are going to question me immediately whether I should be in the room or at the table or opening my mouth. You know, as a diplomat for 30 plus years, you know, how, what do I know about the Middle East, et cetera. So that, it's not enough to get them into an institution. It's not enough to get them into the administration even when they're still walking into these rooms and meeting skepticism, polite curiosity if they're lucky, and hostility, because people are still not expecting us to be in these spaces and don't believe that we should be. That is very much the reality. The president has done a good job, the administration is trying, but that's reality. So watch the space.
All right, we have a number of questions in the room. I know you had your hand up right behind you. Do you still have a question that you want to pose or no?
I still have a question.
No, not you.
Okay, but there's one more behind.
There's we'll come to you. Sorry, you'll go second? Okay. And I know you had a question as well.
Thank you. So I'm Jill Humphreys, and I'm at the University of Toledo, and I'm also an ICAP fellow, class of 97. Thank you, Madam Ambassador,
first year.
We're part of the Pipeline Program, the International Careers Advancement Program for Women and People of Color, started by Dr. Tom Rowe at the University of Denver. So my question is this. My concern is the use of difference as in an instrumental way, so that if you have a multicultural foreign policy establishment, as Dr. Ernie Wilson talks about, that we're just there to sort of present the U.S. as saying that it's truly met its racial democracy, so much sort of like what South Africa is going through, right? But that our actual input doesn't change the actual outcomes. So my interest is, as someone who's been doing applied-based social science as a boundary spanner for 30 years, having worked in Southern Africa at age 22, 30 years later, still doing Africa-based work, is to what extent is having this diverse body in there actually change the outcomes of foreign policy, hence the Horn of Africa, where I just came back from visiting the impact conflict war areas, regions in Ethiopia. So my Ethiopian colleagues, immigrants that are here, who I work with and who I actually advise, which I find interesting, how to find the access points to influence U.S. foreign policy, are disillusioned, because they actually say there's Ambassador Linda Thomas at the United Nations. There's a Madam Ambassador, the Department of State. There's my former colleague and friend, Dr. Cindy Corville, Ambassador Cindy Corville of the African Union, the first ambassador to the African Union. However, the outcomes of U.S. foreign policy still very much, right, is disadvantages, and I'll just say in this context, Africa. So I'm fundamentally more interested in not so much that the M&Ms in the room, right? But to more extent, how do we change the structural and institutional outcomes of this diverse body? One point I will make is that the African-Americans, early African-Americans that entered our foreign policy establishment were part of a larger movement, the civil rights movement, or the larger black freedom movement, and also the national liberation struggles, right? And so they were part of a global movement. Those of us post these movements are very much liberal individualism and not connected, hence Dr. Susan Rice. Mm-hmm. So that's my question. I would also say academia is somewhat different. I've actually seen, since I'm partly in academia, that we have been able to change some of the outcomes, right, by diversifying, because of the creation of ethnic studies centers, gender studies center, LGBTQ. But is that possible in these other institutions? Thank you.
Go for it.
Okay, all right, so real talk. Yeah. I would say that many would say that the outcomes have not been sufficiently impacted, certainly with regard to Africa, and perhaps that's changing under this administration. I think that's why it is important to have a posse, that you can't be the sole voice in a room. You cannot be the sole voice in a room and expect to change anything. You You need more, if not to share your views, but to amplify and welcome. And I tell people that I mentor, the women in particular who don't speak up as often as the men do, you know, even if you don't have the next brilliant idea, if you hear it, support it. Support it and speak out to help people feel comfortable sharing their views. It's hard to disagree with the majority, the way the flow is going in negotiations or foreign policy discussions, and be that lone voice saying, I don't think so, have we considered? And, you know, I've often thought in my career, as we've talked about great power interplay, et cetera, and this is Council on Foreign Relations, what about the people in these countries where the elephants are grappling on top of and having impact on the people, and that we don't have enough discussion of that, or it is women and brown people who are having this discussion among ourselves and not changing the outcomes. More of us are needed in the spaces. Those of us who are in the spaces have to speak out. The amount of courage that is required is extraordinary. It is exhausting, as I mentioned earlier, but it is a requirement if we're going to be there. So again, we need more voices. They're not sufficient yet. That is the reality.
Is this on? Casey McNeil from Fordham University. First, thanks to all of the panelists for this great conversation. I guess I just have a comment I wanted to throw on the table. One thing I was thinking of during this panel was, I guess contrary to what Miguel was saying, I think there's been recent research suggesting that higher ed in the US is, over the last couple of decades, contributing to more inequality rather than less. I think thinking about hiring and tenure and promotion norms is really important here, and particularly the fact that we don't get any pedagogical training really as part of our PhD training. We're not professionally rewarded for putting our time into thinking deeply about how to instruct students from diverse backgrounds. Mm-hmm. You know, we kind of reproduce the things that worked for us, and if we're PhDs, you know, we're not the typical student that's experiencing these things. So just it kind of wanted to put that on the table as things that we all need to be discussing in our departments, because it seems like, you know, diversifying the student body, for example, if then we don't know how to successfully teach students from diverse backgrounds, it's not surprising to me that the outcomes are not changing. So wondering if panelists have thoughts about that.
The what struck me is the absence of pedagogy for pedagogy is really incredible. I was given responsibility for 120 or some 18, 19-year-olds, and I didn't know what I was doing. And I was just making it up as I go along. We've gotten a little bit better on that. On the inequality, I agree that the American university system does play a role in inequality. But given the last 30 years, universities have been better at diversifying and democratizing than a lot of the society has been. We're still a role in inequality. I think a lot of it has to do with just a general culture. And I'm sorry to keep talking about culture, but the culture of promotions. There is a culture of tenure. There is a set of expectations that it's a little bit like the Foreign Service exam, which I took many, many years ago, by the way, and I passed. But a certain person became president, and I couldn't serve. How do we create ways of basically judging, hierarching people, ranking people, that are not as exclusive as these are? I mean, look, there's going to be a process. You can't give everybody tenure. You can't give every single first-year PhD tenure. There simply is not. But we can make the process a little bit more humane. We can make the process take into account things in people's lives. It shouldn't be, I have been I have been shot down at promotion meetings when I point out that somebody is a single mom that has two kids and one of them is got health issues. And they go, well, that's not relevant. And I go, well, wait a minute. Why isn't that relevant? That is what has to change. How to do it systematically, I wish I knew.
And one of the things the deans that we've been working with have struggled with is how do you begin to value, teaching in general more in the tenure and promotion process, but also mentoring and mentorship. And often because we have this issue with the composition of faculty and instructors, the folks who are there and of diverse backgrounds are overwhelmed by the number of students who are seeking them out for advice and mentorship, and yet there's no reward to the instructor for mentoring that individual. And so it's the schools have been, some schools have been really trying to figure out how do you start to recognize the mentoring that's being done, because it's so essential to these students and helping them chart their future. So I think it's an unfinished story, but at least there's growing awareness that this is a real challenge, and you see it in the attrition rates among students and faculty, that the burdens are too much, that the ability to thrive is limited in the absence of guidance and assistance.
I think I'd just add one other thing, and I think this is one thing that's helpful working for an association that spans highly selective, open access, state, liberal arts colleges. We have all, a wide range of institutional members, and that is looking at other institution types, because, of course, for Research One, for elite institutions, yes, teaching is not as valued. But when you look at some other institution types, you can see sort of what are they doing? What can we take from them through the promotion and tenure process that might be applicable? That's helped in the area of community engaged learning. There are some institutions that are now recognizing that as part of the promotion and tenure process that came from some smaller liberal arts colleges and is now moving to other institution types. And the last thing I think is looking at preparing future faculty in those types of programs where they're focusing on pedagogy while students are in graduate school to sort of change the structure and the culture that we've talked about.
That's great. Sir.
Thank you very much. WPS Sidhu from the Center for Global Affairs at NYU. I wanted to connect the discussions of this panel with yesterday's opening panel. DEI, I don't think, is a luxury anymore. It's a necessity. Mm-hmm. And I think that became very clear last night. Because if the US does not understand or know why there's this lack of support on some perspectives, and I know that's the next panel, that's one of the reasons why we need to be more diverse to understand the different perspectives which are coming through. And here I really want to commend Madam Moderator for the initiative that you've taken for diversifying the curricula. I know a colleague of mine is also there on that panel. But it comes back to the question that I have is this almost like a chicken and egg situation of the curricula and the faculty. Kind of which comes first? You're not going to have diversity in curricula if you don't have diverse faculty to some extent. So in that sense, I think, and really kind of a shout out to US academia here, is there a space here to try and create a global IR? How might we go about that? What comes first, the faculty or the curricula or research in some ways to move forward rather than just an American kind of IR? Thank you.
Want to give thoughts?
Sure. What comes first? I think the curriculum has to come first. I think expecting folks, as the ambassador was saying, folks who are junior in a department to then take on the burden of diversifying the curriculum, they're not going to do it. They're going to be, stricter than the strict, because that's what pays off. So I think we do have to change the curriculum. And if we change the curriculum in such a way that we cannot be a real political science department without X, Y, or Z, that will then lead to openings for diversity. So I would put the curriculum first. And there's remarkably little attention paid to curriculum. The number of times that Princeton University has asked itself, why are we here? And what are we teaching? It's not that common of a conversation. And it should be. It should be a conversation every day about what, why are we doing this? What are we trying to create? Are we simply trying to create an elite? Are we simply trying to reproduce ourselves? Or are we trying to create a different kind of human being? So we're trying. We're trying.
I just want to add, and I'm going to come back for a question, a slightly different perspective, because I've been working with, at Georgetown, doing faculty workshops with all of the different programs in the School of Foreign Service to help people reimagine their courses, to think about these diversity, equity, inclusion issues, how they can weave them into any subfield in IR, because you're right. I mean, people teach what they were taught. So getting them to think differently about the entire way they're teaching and what needs to be taught requires some work. And there are those who are sort of like, you know, talk to the hand, I'm not interested in changing. But a lot of them are really interested in that exchange, in learning about the research that's out there that shows how important this is and why it's becoming more important to engage. And they welcome the intellectual exchange. So I think they have to go in tandem, often because curricular changes are big bureaucratic changes that are required. And so you need a move incrementally forward, and faculty turnover, as we all know, over decades, mm-hmm. right? Your most senior faculty are around for a long time. So you have to work with the faculty assembly as configured, even as you try to make the more transformational changes.
I'll say one thing really quickly. Also, I think, again, you'll say I'm one note, Dawn, but looking at the type of institution, because some of our institutions, their curriculum is under high scrutiny by the state and by others. Mm. So I think you are seeing in certain areas and certain types of institutions where they're getting that external, you know, emphasis, and that magnifier is going on folks there.
Great. I'm going to go way back there just because I want to make sure, since I'm angled this way, that I'm covering the whole room.
Thank you. Colette Mazzucchelli, New York University. I'd like to follow up on what my colleague just commented on and go to curriculum and faculty both. In my mind, if you're at an institution like NYU, which is by definition a global network university, then you really have the need to reach deep into a local area to diversify. And that, in my mind, suggests that it really cannot be the curriculum that comes first, with all due respect. I think it has to be the initiative of the person to reach out. And that's where I think the faculty workshops, I agree with you on that. But I think there needs to be more of a coordination in terms of how colleagues talk about what they're teaching and learning and how they cooperate in what they do. I mean, the collaboration, I think, is essential. And that's hard because you do have differences in terms of levels of faculty members, who's coming in when. And depending on when they're coming in, that kind of, in a sense, influences the pedagogy, the way they approach a curriculum. And now with all this digitalization, it's a brave new world. So I think for those coming up, there's that added layer. And I think how we address this is going to be particularly important, because I think diversity inclusion comes from how you're also addressing the technological innovations. And there I think state's been, you know, very proactive in having these opportunities to bring members of the State Department into our classrooms with the technologies. I know that my students love, because they're interacting directly with professionals. They enjoy it. They learn about how they could see themselves in that type of a career. And the diversity and the inclusion is built right in. So you have a kind of seamless approach in the learning. And that, I think, is something that I would say state continues, and we piggyback off of that. And it becomes, again, a collaborative type of effort. So I understand what you're saying about curriculum, but from my perspective, I think it goes the other way. It's the person, and then the curriculum is influenced through the collaboration. Thank you.
Thanks for that comment. And I want to actually pivot and ask you, from a precept standpoint, what would you have students come in knowing and learning? Mm-hmm. Because that can, in some ways, guide all of these educators.
Yeah. Well, I think we have spent a great deal of focus in our examination looking at how candidates might deal with different cultures. When you get into different situations around the world that are not American, how do you get done what you've come to do in a respectful, open-minded fashion. And that's what we've been judging, but we also are now expecting our candidates to know more about America. You know, that I remember someone explaining to me how, you know, how much I know about majority America and how little majority America knew about my role, my part of the culture that is America. And our exam did not test that, but there are certainly increased questions so that when you are representing the United States, you can represent all of it, all of it. And so knowing our history, you know, people are suddenly discovering Tulsa, or they're suddenly discovering, there's a wonderful documentary on PBS, you can find it at pbs.org, called The American Diplomat. And I love the title of it. All the diplomats discussed are African Americans from the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. And I cried when I saw it because I didn't know about them. And these were people that, one, was still alive and working in the Foreign Service when I joined, and I did not know about him, even though he had the second highest number of ambassadorships in the Department of State. And I didn't even know he existed. And that's the Department of State's error in not showing us as diplomats our full history. So we're working to correct that, to expand that knowledge. And so what the definitions of excellence is for someone graduating, for someone coming into the international relations field, means you got to know all of it, to be able to say that you're truly an expert or you have an expertise or a specialty. You've got to know all of it. So,
well, that will be our final word for this session. Please, we will have a, join me in first of all in thanking our panel for a great conversation.